Hi, I'm Abhik Majumdar from the National Law University of Research, Cuttack. Today, I shall talk to you about cyber crimes. Now, cyber crime has become a very popular buzzword these days. Many reasons can be attributed to this because today, computers have become almost ubiquitous in every sphere of our lives. We have come to depend on computers much more than we used to, right? And we also have developed this consequent fear, which is real or otherwise, that because of our dependence, we have made ourselves more vulnerable to threats. Then the online world is itself changing very rapidly, perhaps too rapidly for most people to comprehend. 10 years ago, we were reasonably well connected online, but life in cyberspace was very different. Think about it. Email was used extensively for leisure purposes also, not just for work. Social networks still meant high five or Orkut. Facebook was restricted only to American schools and colleges, and it was effectively unknown in India. Yahoo Messenger was how we used to chat. Making online purchases was treated very skeptically, and there was every chance that we would pay and not get what we paid for. Most important, back then the internet meant computers, nothing but computers. One simply could not conceive of small pocket-sized devices with touchscreens and 8-core processors powerful enough to do all our tasks and yet small enough to fit into our pocket and therefore a tempting target for pickpockets. Okay, mobile thefts were common. Back then, I have had 2 phones stolen myself. But at that time, the target for thieves were the handsets, not the data contained therein. Today, the data inside stolen mobile phones are as lucrative a target for pickpockets as the phone themselves are. At times, they are more important targets. Another aspect of this issue, that information technology law is still in a stage of nascence in many parts of the world, including India. Our police are ill-equipped to even understand the nature of most cyber crimes, let alone regulate or investigate them. Then our cybercrime laws often suffer a disconnect with their own purposes and intents. At times they are too lenient, at times they are too strict. While this may be a reflection of laws generally in this country, it matters much more in the cyber environment, which as we saw is changing at a terrifying pace. So this is cyberspace. This is the cyberspace that we are all familiar with. Now let me focus on the kind of learning objectives that this module entails. First, we shall cover the following areas. We shall undertake a brief overview of the nature and background of cybercrime and its various forms. Next, we shall examine certain specified acts that have not been accorded any nomenclature but still characteristically attract civil and also in certain circumstances criminal liability as well. After that, we shall discuss those acts that are properly known as cybercrimes, including but not restricted to sending offensive messages, identity theft, impersonation, violation of privacy, and so on. Within this discourse, we shall examine the nature and character of each offense, case law, and in some cases, parallel legal developments in other systems. Now, the first thing we need to clarify is, what is cybercrime? How do we understand cybercrime? Now, when dealing with cybercrimes, arguably the first thing that occurs to us is, how different are cyber crimes for ordinary real world crimes? Are they variants of the crimes that we know and are familiar with already, or are they a new species of crime altogether? So should they be treated as simply traditional crimes wrapped up in gigabytes and modems, or should they be treated as something completely new, completely unprecedented? According to Warren and Streeter, the answer lies somewhere in between. There are different types of cybercrimes. Some of them very closely resemble what we know in the real world. Identity theft, impersonation, and violation of privacy, for example, are only variations of crimes that had existed long before the advent of computers. On the other hand, take something like the propagation of viruses, which affects computers on such a large scale that few, if any, parallels exist in the realm of traditional crimes. I quote from Warren and Streeter here, It is said sometimes that virus writing is a little like graffiti writing, in other words, an act of vandalism by a usually young man seeking attention. Yet when a kid spray paints a wall or a fence, he knows precisely what damage he is causing and to whom. A virus writer unleashes his little program of misery upon the world, not knowing or apparently caring who or what he will damage and on what scale. Okay, so it's at least clear that whether or not cyber crimes are variations of traditional crimes, they feature certain common characteristics that set them apart from the latter, that is to say real world crimes. The first is that they can be perpetrated on immense scales using little by way of resources and equipment. At times they require, all they require is a computer and a good internet connection. Secondly, they can be and are frequently are committed with the utmost ease across national boundaries. Apart from causing procedural problems like jurisdiction, extradition and investigation, this also creates issues of criminal liability such as the proper law for determining culpability, standard of proof and similar issues. Thirdly, and arguably something that has not attracted the attention of jurists as much as the other two points have, the notions of mens rea and actus reus necessarily have to be viewed differently in the context of cybercrime. In many cases, mens rea can be inferred from the commission of the act itself. If you want to hack into a computer network, it means to either have the intention to unauthorizedly gain entry or knowledge that by doing certain acts you will be gaining entry. So nobody can commit a network hack by negligence or by accident. The way in the real world people can commit certain crimes through negligence, accident, etc. Even when it comes to acts like propagating viruses or hacking into damaging a network or a website simply for the fun of it, the sheer magnitude of recklessness it entails is sufficient to justify criminal liability. The last difference between real world crimes and cyber crimes is that since these offenses are of comparatively recent origin, their existence, scope and ambit are determined mostly through statute law. Judicial precedents play a comparatively minor role here, especially in Indian law. Beyond these four characteristics, there is little that binds together the various acts which are classified as cyber crimes. Now we go on to how cybercrime began to be recognized in Indian law. Cybercrime gained recognition in India when the Information Technology Act of 2000 came into force. Shortly thereafter, the lacunae of the legislation, particularly in connection with penal provisions, became painfully apparent. Consequently, the Act was amended comprehensively in 2008, in which process equal attention was given to penal provisions. New provisions were introduced dealing with materials like transmitting offensive material, child pornography and cyber terrorism. At the same time, certain existing sections were also amended and their character or ambit altered. For example, part 9 of the Act, which was earlier titled Penalties and Adjudication, now became Penalties, Compensation and Adjudication. Now, before we go on to crimes proper, we need to familiarize ourselves with certain definitions which always need to be kept in mind in the course of this discussion. We shall frequently encounter terms such as computer, computer resource, computer system and so on. Clause 1 of section 2 defines computer in terms of data processing devices that can perform logic, arithmetic and memory functions and includes all peripherals performing input, output, processing, storage, etc. functions and connected or related to a computer in a computer system or a computer network. Similarly, clause J of section 2 construes computer network in terms of interconnecting one or more computers or computer systems or communication devices. Computer resource, that is clause K, is a generic term that includes within its scope computers, communication devices, computer system, even databases and software among other things. Lastly, clause L defines computer system. It is not a clearly worded provision, and at first sight it does not make it clear where the difference between a computer and a computer system lies. When we look at the provision a bit closer, the difference becomes apparent. The difference is that the latter indicates a device or a collection of devices of a certain type, namely capable of being programmed, input and output data, and so on. Having discussed definitions, the next topic we need to take up is called cyber contraventions and computer related offenses. Now, one of the more curious aspects of the IT Act is Chapter 9, which, as we mentioned, is titled Penalties, Compensations and Adjudication. It stretches from Section 43 to Section 47 and covers a variety of substantive and procedural provisions, not all of which are linked to one another. Commentators like Sharma use the term cyber contraventions to denote this chapter, but this is not a descriptive in popular circulation, and in any case, it reveals little about what kind of contraventions the section addresses. A cursory look at the substantive provisions included here, and particularly at the penalties and compensation amounts specified, suggests that these acts are in the nature of cyber torts. Section 43 is of particular interest to us. The title of the section reads Penalty and Compensation for Damage to Computer, Computer System, etc. Like in the title of Part 9, the word compensation was not present originally and was added to the heading in 2008. It comprises a total of 10 specific acts, the commission of which invites damages by way of compensation not exceeding 1 crore rupees to the person affected. Curiously, the section makes no mention at all of penalties, even though the title of the provision specifically mentions penalties. Once again, the title to the section is misleading because it discloses little about the nature of the acts mentioned. On examining the provision in detail, though, it becomes clear that it addresses mainly issues relating to hacking and related activities. These include A. accessing a computer or computer system without authorization, B. downloading, copying or extracting data, C. infecting a computer or a system with a contaminant or virus, D. damaging a computer system network, data stored within it, etc., E. disrupting a computer system or network, F. denying access, G. providing assistance to another to gain unauthorized access, H. directing monetary charges to another person's account, I. destroying, deleting or altering data inside a computer resource, and J. stealing source code. The term access in clause A has to be understood in the light of the definition provided in section 2 clause 1 subclause A. It says it defines access as gaining into, instructing or communicating with a computer, computer system or computer network. Clause C uses the term contaminant and virus. The distinction between the two can be appreciated by the explanations 1 and 3 to the section. According to the former, contaminants characteristically modify, destroy, record and or transmit information and usurp the normal functioning of the computer, computer system or computer network. Viruses, on the other hand, have two characteristics. One, they destroy, damage, degrade or adversely affect the performance of computer resource, etc. And two, they attach themselves to another computer resource on the occurrence of some specified event, like an instruction being executed. It's interesting to note that barring this explanation, the Act does not define a virus anywhere, particularly within Section 2. Given the importance of virus to IT law, this treatment meted out to viruses does appear strange. Clause D is understood to extend to two kinds of damage, namely physical damage and virtual damage. The categories are self-explanatory. The first involves manually tampering with the target computer system or network and so on. The second involves performing similar acts remotely, either through a network like the internet or perhaps to viruses or bots that transmit themselves to portable storage media like flash drives. Clause F specifically addresses what is known as a DDoS, that is distributed denial of service attacks. A common tactic among malicious hackers to block access to certain sites, usually e-commerce sites. This involves a group of miscreants continually accessing the site services with such rapidity that the targeted server is unable to handle the unprecedented traffic and ultimately crashes. Clause H is significant because it protects services bought and paid for by individuals. A classic example is internet time or data limits purchased from service providers. Inexpert users tend not to take basic precautions such as using passwords that are difficult to guess and making their Wi-Fi connection secure. As a result, it becomes easy for others in the vicinity to access the services that the user had paid for. A question arises here whether such services should be treated as movable property. We may for this purpose draw a parallel with similar issues concerning the theft of electricity, which the Supreme Court addressed in the case called Avtar Singh versus State of Punjab. Here the court clarified that electricity will not amount to movable property, and hence section 378 of IPC 1860, which deals with theft, shall not apply directly. However, due to a legal fiction created by section 39 of the Electricity Act of 1910, electricity theft shall attract punishment for theft specified in section 379 of IPC. It has been suggested that a similar interpretation can be resorted to through section 43 clause H of the IT Act. On closer inspection though, this proves unsustainable. Section 39 of the Electricity Act explicitly uses the word theft, albeit in the marginal heading, whereas section 43 clause H does not do so anywhere. All it talks about is charging to the account of one person services actually used by another person. Surely, to create the desired legal fiction, some express use of the word theft would be necessary. Then again, section 378 requires as essential elements such as taking the property out of the possession of the victim. The Electricity Act can certainly sustain a legal fiction regarding such taking out of possession. Section 39 begins with the words, "Whoever dishonestly abstracts, consumes or uses." The use of the word abstracts is surely sufficient for this legal fiction. However, section 43 clause H of the Information Technology Act contains no such word or words. Can it still sustain a similar legal fiction? This question actually leads to our next point within the discussion on section 43, namely, why are we discussing these so-called contraventions when our mandate concerns cybercrime specifically? Admittedly, section 43 does not contemplate anything beyond monetary compensation, for which it sets an upper limit of rupees 1 crore. It does not even impose penalties, contrary to what the provision's title suggests. The interesting thing is, even prior to the 2008 amendment, when the title of the section simply read penalty for damage to computer, computer systems, etc., etc., and did not contain the word compensation, the provision, that is to say, the text of the provision still contemplated damages by way of compensation not exceeding 1 crore rupees, which meant that even back then, when the title of the provision did not contain the word compensation but did contain the word penalty, the text of the provision contained only compensation and not penalty. To understand the penal implications of section 43, we need to look at section 66 titled Computer Related Offences. This imposes on any dishonest or fraudulent commission of an act specified in section 43 imprisonment of up to 3 years and a fine of rupees 5 lakhs or both. The provision in its present form dates back to 2008. Prior to the 2008 amendment, it was entitled simply Hacking with Computer System, and it imposed penalty for intentionally or knowingly destroying, deleting or altering information within a computer resource, etc. It would seem therefore that subsequent to the amendment, the Act no longer features a provision explicitly dedicated to hacking, and Now, any such act, that is to say any such act involving hacking, can be made punishable only if it falls under one or the other clauses of section 43, of course read with section 66. Indeed, if you do a word search for the word hack, hacking, hacker, etc., etc., we find that none of these words are any longer found in the text of the act. Before we move on to the next topic, it may be noted that part 9 contemplates contraventions beyond section 43. These include failure to protect data, that is section 43A, and failure to furnish information returns, etc., section 44. But section 66 references only section 43 and not these other ones, which means that they fall outside the purview of cyber crimes and hence outside the purview of our discussion as well. The next thing we discuss is tampering with source documents. Section 65 falls within part 11 of the act entitled offences. Prior to the 2008 amendment, the part was compact in size and contained a limited number of provisions. After the amendment, the number of provisions has gone up considerably, which may be classified into different categories according to their context. Section 65, however, sits ill at ease with these framework of categories and so is best treated separately. The provision comprises the following elements: A. Intention or knowledge, B. Concealment, destroying or altering or causing another to do the same, C. any computer source code, and D. when the computer source code is legally required to be kept or maintained. Contraventions attract a maximum punishment of 3 years imprisonment and or a fine of up to rupees 2 lakhs. No illustrations have been provided, but the explanation to the provision defines source code as the listing of programs, computer commands, design and layout and program analysis of computer resource in any form. This unusually broad conception of source code was adopted in Syed Asifuddin versus State of Andhra Pradesh. This was a case decided by the Andhra Pradesh High Court in 2005, and it involved some Tata Indicom employees who were arrested for obtaining CDMA cell phones meant to run exclusively on the Reliance network and then tampering with them so that they were now unlocked and could now run on other networks including Tata Indicom. The issue was whether the 10 digit mobile identification number derived from a cell phone number given to a subscriber and especially the 32 bit electronic serial number ESN assigned to or programmed into each handset and the 5 digit systems identification code SID assigned to each telecom carrier by the government of India amounted to source code within the meaning of section 65. The court decided that source codes are types of programs and then concluded that since ESN is a permanent part of a phone and MIN and SID are programmed into the phone at the time of purchase, all three satisfy the definition of source code and thus tampering with them to unlock the phones amounted to an offence under section 65. It is respectfully submitted that the court did not fully appreciate what constitutes a program and particularly how a program differs from data. A program necessarily includes a general set of instructions, whereas data is always specific to particular situations. Next, now we discuss offences introduced by the 2008 amendment. The 2008 amendment inserted into the act a series of offences found in sections 66A to 66F. They relate to a diverse range of issues including offensive messages, dishonestly receiving stolen computer resources, identity theft, etc. Section 66A deals with sending offensive messages. It has come in for harsh criticism because of the very wide wording used in it. It lists 3 different kinds of acts to be undertaken through a computer resource or communication device, namely sending grossly offensive or menacing information, knowingly sending false information for causing annoyance, inconvenience, danger, etc., and sending emails for annoyance or inconvenience or to deceive the addressee about their origin. It is manifest that the terms used here are certainly very wide and in fact undefined. For example, there has been no definition provided for what constitutes grossly offensive. Case law does not help us here. In Shaju Sebastian versus State of Kerala, the Kerala High Court held that it could not be prima facie that captions added to newspapers were inoffensive in character. Beyond this, there is no case law that deals with these kind of issues. There exists a tendency to interpret Section 66A in very wide terms otherwise also. In Jeevan versus State of Maharashtra, a mobile repair shop owner had copied some obscene clips from the handset of a customer, but he had not circulated them. The sessions judge had dismissed his revision application against the order of the magistrate by saying that since the accused ran a mobile phone shop, there is every possibility that he might have circulated the clip among his customers via Bluetooth. The High Court passed sharp remarks against this and pointed out that in the absence of any evidence that the accused had circulated the clip or even a specific charge to that effect, a prosecution under Section 66A could not be sustained. On the other hand, the Delhi High Court in Karan Girithra v. State held that a charge of recording a nude video clip of a woman and then blackmailing her by threatening to circulate it constituted per se adequate grounds for denial of anticipatory bail. Section 66B deals with dishonestly receiving stolen computer resources or communication devices. Section 66C addresses the issue of identity theft, that is, fraudulently or dishonestly making use of the electronic signature, password or any other unique identification feature of any other person. Section 66D concerns cheating by impersonation through any communication device or computer resource. Case law on these provisions, such as State v. Rajesh Gosai, Delhi High Court, and Sandeep Varghese v. State of Kerala, Kerala High Court, tend to center around procedural aspects like bail applications and quashing of proceedings rather than substantive issues. Section 66E pertains to a violation of privacy. This entails A, intentionally or knowingly, B, capturing, publishing or transmitting, C, the image of a private area of a person, D, without his or her consent, and E, under circumstances violating the privacy of that person. Explanation B states that capture amounts to videotaping, photographing, filming or recording by any means. More interestingly, explanation E defines privacy as circumstances in which a person can have a reasonable expectation that 1. He or she could disrobe in privacy without being concerned that an image of his private area was being captured, or 2. Any part of his or her private area which would not be visible to the public regardless of whether that person is in a public or a private place. Once again, little exists by way of case law. In Sani Dhiman versus State of Punjab, prosecution under this provision was allowed to be quashed even though the offense is not compoundable. This was done because a compromise had been reached between the parties and also keeping in mind the future life of the third respondent, who was an unmarried girl. Section 66F deals with cyber terrorism. This contemplates two kinds of acts, namely A, intending to threaten the unity, integrity, security or sovereignty of India, or to strike terror into the people of any section or any section of the people, 1. Through DDoS attacks, 2. By hacking into a computer resource, 3. By introducing a contaminant into a resource and through such act cause death, destruction of property, disruption of essential supplies, etc. and B. Hacking into a computer resource to uncover crucial state secrets. Clause 2 punishes such acts with imprisonment, which may stretch to life imprisonment also. So far, no cases on this provision could be located. 7. Obscenity under the IT Act. Section 67 to 67B deal with obscenity in cyberspace. Section 67 is simple and imposes punishment for publication or transmission of material that is A, lascivious, or B, appeals to the prurient interest, or C, tends to deprave or corrupt people likely to read, see or hear it. First convictions entail imprisonment of up to 3 years and a fine of up to Rs. 5 lakhs. For subsequent convictions, the maximum penalties are raised to 5 years imprisonment and Rs. 10 lakhs respectively. Unlike section 67A, this provision does not make exception for artistic, literary and religious works. Moreover, the content of the definition must be examined in the light of how Indian law treats obscenity as such. The test most prevalent was laid down by the Supreme Court in Ranjit Udeshi versus State of Maharashtra, which holds that the courts have to examine if the material considered amounts to a depraving or corrupting influence on those into whose hands the work is likely to fall. The resemblance between this principle and section 67 is manifest. More important, the test itself is largely derivative of the test devised back in the 19th century in R versus Hickling. In recent times, obscenity tests have become more sophisticated. The Supreme Court decision Miller versus California advocates a three-pronged approach, that is, whether the average person applying contemporary community standards would find that the work taken as a whole appealed to the prurient interest, 2. Whether the work depicts or describes in a patently offensive way sexual conduct specifically defined by applicable state law, and 3. Whether the work taken as a whole lacks serious literary, artistic, political or scientific value. A notable development in this regard is the infamous Bazi case. This concerns a video clip depicting two school students engaged in certain explicit acts which had gone viral over the net some years ago. An enterprising engineering student began to sell CDs of this clip over the e-commerce site Bazi.com, which is subsequently bought out by eBay. Now, although the site itself had not committed any wrongdoing and had put in place all reasonable filters to block the sale of obscene content, which the seller had managed to circumvent, the Delhi High Court still convicted the CEO of Bazi under this provision. Section 67A is a more specific provision which applies to publishing or transmitting in electronic form material which contains sexually explicit act or conduct. First offences carry prison terms of up to 5 years and fines of up to rupees 10 lakhs. Subsequent offences may attract prison terms of up to 7 years. Exceptions protect material in the interests of science, art, learning, etc., or for bona fide religious purposes. Section 67B is a still more specific provision intended to prevent the production and propagation through the internet of child pornography. Lastly, section 67C requires intermediaries such as, for example, ISPs to retain certain material as per the specifications of the government. Individuals intentionally or knowingly failing to do so may be imprisoned for up to 3 years and also be subjected to fine. To conclude, let us sum up what we have seen so far. In this module, we took a broad overview of the notion of cybercrime. We saw that it comprised a vast area. Many acts deemed to be cybercrimes were little connection with each other. Some are variants of crimes recognized in the offline world, others have no equivalent in the latter. However, several characteristics are common to at least most among them. They include perpetration on an immense scale through minimal resources, commission across national boundaries, easily determinable mens rea, and lastly, reliance on statute law. The crimes themselves can be classified into 4 broad categories, namely acts related to unauthorized access or hacking, that is section 66, tampering with source documents, section 65, obscenity, section 67 to section 67B, and new offences introduced by the 2008 amendment, that is section 66A to 66F. It is clear that the law relating to these offences are in a state of nascence, which is only underscored by the dearth of case law. As time passes, their character, scope and ambit will surely attain greater levels of maturity. Thank you.